headlines when you said you plan to run for governor in 2021, but you've mentioned the possibility of running for governor before, but perhaps not as strongly as saying, I plan to run. Last time you were on this show, you said that running for governor is something that you were thinking about. Now you're saying you plan to run. Can you give us a sense of how likely you are to run and what factors are going into your decision?
Yeah, well, thank you again, Kojo, for having me. Thank you, Martin. We did announce that I do plan to run for governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia in 2021. And we've seen tremendous excitement around that announcement.
What's the difference between saying you're planning to run and officially announcing that you're running?
So it's a great question. And I'm a lawyer and a whole bunch of lawyers here. But obviously, when you start running, it triggers certain legal obligations and disclosures and things. So you'd want to get all of that in order. But, you know, we wanted to make it clear to everyone that is, you know, our intent. And again, the response has been really tremendous and positive and overwhelming. And I've traveled all around the Commonwealth of Virginia, as you know, really over the last 7 years, but as Lieutenant Governor over the last two. And we've been to every part of Virginia, Southwest, South Side. I was just in Roanoke and Danville. I was in Norfolk yesterday in Hampton Roads. And, you know, everywhere we go, I mean, there are crowds of people who are just energized by the positive message, the more hopeful politics that we represent. And they're really, frankly, tired of people who try to tear people and communities down, and they want people who are going to build people and communities up. And that's really what we've represented in politics in Virginia.
In February, you were accused of sexual misconduct by two women, both allegations you have denied. How have those allegations affected your thinking about running for governor?
You know, I think what people have gotten to see over the last 10 months is that these allegations were false, fabricated, and politically motivated. And anyone who's really paying attention and asking really direct questions about the facts and the evidence and the truth see that these have been debunked. And in fact, we have called, as you know, for the past 10 months for investigations and independent investigations, criminal investigations. I've taken and passed two lie detector tests, which we have released to the public. And now we've sued CBS for $400 million for their reckless disregard for the truth and airing these false accusations, despite the fact that there's been evidence and information that these allegations are false. And so, you know, as folks like to sort of just rehash these, you know, mindlessly rehash these allegations without actually asking questions, are they true? And asking questions specifically about each of the cases, you know, Virginians have really rejected that. And again, for anyone who wants to kind of just keep talking about this without actually asking the specific questions, I would tell them, please call Nancy Erica Smith, who is the lawyer for Meredith Watson, the accuser from Duke, and ask her some very simple questions. Whose dorm room did this happen in, and was there anyone else there? Because they can't answer those questions, because once they answer them, for 5 months, they have refused to answer those questions because it will reveal that Meredith Watson fabricated the story. Dr. Vanessa Tyson as well. We've shown many fabrications in her account. Including that she, you know, claims to have met me on a day that I wasn't even in the city, where she didn't know me. And so, you know, we have been transparent. We have told the truth from day one. And Virginians are incredibly smart. I give them so much more credit than most people in politics. They were able to see right through this. And here we are 10 months later, and people say they remain unresolved. Well, you know, smear campaigns aren't intended to be resolved. The whole point of them is to throw out the allegations and never to investigate, never to get to the truth. And Virginians are way smarter than that.
So you say, obviously, Virginians are way smarter than that, but there's going to be a lot of Virginians, as is the case in politics generally. They will read the news now and again. They'll read the headlines now and again. Mm-hmm. The one thing they may have read was the allegations from earlier this year, and they may just remember the headlines. They may not remember everything thereafter. I mean, are you concerned that part of the campaign is going to be run on the defensive to a certain degree, having to explain what you just said to us to voters? And do you think they're going to buy it? Do you think they're going to say this is just too much? Like, we just want someone who doesn't have potentially these allegations against them?
Not at all. And in fact, again, what Virginians are doing is they're rejecting smear tactics. You know, we have someone in the White House, 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, who lies to us every single day. And people say, well, you know, he's lying and we're overwhelmed and we just don't want to deal with it. No, people want people who are telling the truth. They want people who are engaging in politics that are uplifting politics, that are building people and communities up. They are really exhausted. And I'm telling you, I've traveled all around the state. They are exhausted of people in politics, especially politicians and people behind the scenes, orchestrating smear campaigns and doing hit pieces and not wanting to get to the truth. And, you know, they really are exhausted. And I'm telling you, people are going to be really surprised at the reaction that they're seeing. I mean, I have gone into so many different communities, but in particular, I've gone to different African American mm-hmm. churches. You go to an African American church in Virginia, and in particular, I was in Alfred Street Baptist Church recently, and there's so many other great churches, First Baptist Church of Vienna. You go there and you ask people what they think about these allegations. They think about the fact that they don't want to talk about them now, that the truth is out, that they think about that you would use, again, actually one of the historically most racist tropes in American history, to accuse an African American man with zero evidence of a crime of this nature and then not want to talk about it. The backlash has been tremendous. And people, again, want to be uplifted. They want hope. And that's really what we represent.
When you first